going to have some closing remarks. I'm pleased to introduce Jen Phillips from the Ocean Protection Council. She leads the California Ocean Protection Council's work on ocean acidification and hypoxia and other climate change strategies related to ocean and coasts. Jen works closely with other West Coast states and provinces through the West Coast Ocean Partnership and the Pacific Coast Collaborative on Marine and Coastal Resource Planning and Management, and globally as the California point person for the International Alliance to Combat Ocean Acidification. Before joining the OPC, she served on NOAA's Administrator Staff as a Knaus Marine Policy Fellow and continuing on to serve as a liaison between headquarters and the region's advancing and scoping agency priorities related to resilience and supporting leadership, outreach, and communications.
This has been really interesting for me today to listen to all of the different talks and case studies and examples about planning and implementation. And I just kind of wanted to give a little bit of a context about who Ocean Protection Council is, where we're heading, and sort of the opportunity for your work to be elevated in this space, and kind of thread together some themes we've heard throughout the day. And my executive director, Deborah Halberstadt, was supposed to be here, but you get me, so sorry in advance. And she does really want to hear about this meeting and really sends her regards. So thank you again for having us. So just a bit of context about Ocean Protection Council. Many of you probably know this, but we have a pretty unique role in government to really kind of speed up some of the examples and the work that we've talked about today. And what I mean by that is we're sort of a cabinet-level state body, and the secretary of the California Natural Resources Agency is the chair of our council. So effectively, we have this direct line to the governor's office, and we serve as the governor's point people on ocean and coastal policy matters. So our mission, broadly, is to ensure healthy, resilient, and productive ocean and coastal ecosystems in California. And we work to do this by improving the coordination of state coastal agencies like the State Coastal Conservancy and Coastal Commission, and work really closely with people like Mary. We also really ensure that the best available science is informing our decision making. So if there are barriers to work getting done at the state or local level, that is a place where Ocean Protection Council can kind of step in and make sure that there aren't those roadblocks and we do have the best information moving forward. Also, we identify sort of changes in policy and law that can really improve the protection of marine ecosystems moving forward. And then, of course, we have this grant-making arm to, again, ensure that decision-making is swift and that people like you working on the ground and at different scales really have the pathway to swift and speedy action. You know, kind of our formula for success is really trying to overall improve ecosystem health, strengthen governance in California, leverage partnerships, so this means internally and externally, with academia and NGOs and tribes and foundations, and really, as we just talked about in the last session, cultivate the next generation of ocean stewards. So we're always trying to navigate this balance between science and policy and kind of respecting the different vantage points that we all have in this space. So we work on a lot of things, We have several priorities, but I think the point here is that, you know, climate change, as we've been talking about today, kind of overlays a lot of things we think about, from marine protected areas to sustainable fisheries. So when we work at Ocean Protection Council, we always try to think about kind of how everything needs to be viewed in this context of climate and changing conditions. And as the last panel was just talking about, or I think you were talking about kind of how you used to view things when you were in planning school, we try to always view things in this adaptive way that you never know what's going to change and evolve in a matter of decades or years. So that is kind of the lens we try to bring with all of our work. So our climate change vision, because of sort of our unique value proposition here, when we talk about climate change, my goal really is to always make sure that ocean impacts are woven into all of the state's ambitious policies on climate adaptation and climate mitigation. And again, that we're sort of elevating the profile of the work that's being done. So when we talk about California's ambitious climate change policies, people do think about what we're doing as far as ocean climate and as far as coastal resiliency. So that is really our vision for, again, enhancing coastal resilience and kind of paving the way for this work to get done quickly, and also recognizing that everything we've talked about here today is in this context of California's climate change strategy. So a little bit of how we do that. Obviously, we work kind of specifically on sea level rise, and as Tegan mentioned, on ocean acidification and hypoxia. And Tina leads a lot of our sea level rise work, and I work a lot on ocean acidification. So we try to, you know, we try to, within these silos of our Ocean Protection Council climate work, really advance policies, whether it's the sea level rise policy guidance, or right now we're working on a state plan on ocean acidification. But we also try to weave in oceans into these multi-sector engagements. So through the fourth climate change assessment and through the Safeguarding California plan, which is the state's adaptation plan. The one thing I really wanted to say about the sea level rise guidance, and I know you got the update from Tina, is that the sea level rise guidance sort of, again, OPC is not a regulatory agency. So what we try to do with the sea level rise guidance is really be as precautionary and bold as we possibly can be, but also realistic about what is going to happen and the potential changes that are going to happen under various emission scenarios. And we really tried to outline some bold adaptation strategies that can be employed. So again, when we talked about natural solutions or living shorelines, or however we phrased it today, that is something we really highlight in the sea level rise guidance. And also when we talked about managed retreat today, that is again another sort of strategy. So when you're thinking about your work on the local level, it's really helpful to be able to point to these statewide guidance documents that sort of amplify the thinking and the messages. So we're right now working on the California Fourth Climate Change Assessment, and that has been talked about in Walter's presentation and many other presentations today. But what we tried to really push for in this iteration of the climate change assessment was having an ocean and coastal sector, or an ocean and coastal topical report, all to see kind of these case studies that have been mentioned throughout the day, or sort of bold strategies kind of coalesce into one topical report of the climate change assessment. So sort of looking forward, you know, we're doing a lot right now kind of trying to elevate and amplify this work, but we also have a lot kind of on the near term as ways to continue to kind of elevate this issue and provide more pathways for elevating it into a broader climate change discussion. And one of the big things that we're working on right now at Ocean Protection Council is leading the planning for the ocean sessions of the Global Climate Action Summit. And the Global Climate Action Summit is an event that will be hosted by Governor Brown, Michael Bloomberg, and other climate champions in San Francisco in September. And it's really a moment to make bold commitments and highlight statements of achievement that have happened on the ground and locally up to kind of a global level. And it's a moment to recognize, particularly their goal here is recognizing kind of subnational players that are really pushing this conversation along and encouraging national leadership to make more bold statements and kind of follow suit to what we're all talking about here in the room. So that's kind of a near-term opportunity. And then, of course, looking forward, I think really trying to think about how we appropriately implement these guidance documents, like the sea level rise guidance document, and other strategies that really try to focus on kind of no regret strategies, that whatever projects we're employing are good for many reasons besides the obvious coastal benefit or carbon sequestration or whatever it may be. And then longer term, I really want us to continue to kind of weave in and have a sustained investment strategy for oceans and coasts and make sure that, you know, there is a designated way for oceans and coasts to get cap and trade funding, because we are both affected by climate impacts and a solution to climate impacts. So just kind of hitting again on the Global Climate Action Summit and the opportunity here. When this first was sort of coalescing, it was organized into a bunch of challenge areas, focused a lot on kind of transportation and zero emission vehicles, and there was a small section on land, and this whole community came together and said, you still need to think about the oceans and the climate conversation. So now we're firmly part of that discussion, and I'm really excited to see kind of what the California community can bring to that meeting, what work that can be amplified and kind of scaled to a global level, other examples from the Netherlands and New York City that kind of can be highlighted and talked about throughout the summit, so that we're leading into kind of the next global climate targets, and we're really more bold and ambitious because of what we're talking about at a subnational and local level. So I think I will stop there, but just wanted to again acknowledge the work you're all doing, and it's been really good for me to kind of sit in the back of the room and absorb what is happening across the state, what is happening across the United States, and kind of the response and the persistence sometimes even in lack of national leadership or other types of leadership. So I really commend the work you're doing, and thank you for giving me this space to provide some closing remarks.